Good morning. The Lord be with you. Welcome to worship. It's so good to see you here in worship today. So glad that you were able to join us. I want to say that I've seen already Jody and Bill, and I guess Jeff's there with you, Jody, and the rest of your crew too, Bill, I imagine, as you forward this with to others on your site. Thank you for sharing this worship with them. And Jan and Tim and Swagger as well, and I see Mary's out there, and Henry is out there, and Anita is out there too. So great to see you, not out there, but here, for worship with us. Good morning and welcome to worship. As you're joining us for worship today, oh, you don't have sound. Uh-oh, you're not hearing anything, Bonnie? I'm not sure what's going on. If others of you are not hearing, please do let us know. That would be bad news, because we've had the prelude already. I just wanted to share a few bits of information with you. Hopefully you're hearing this. And that is that we celebrated a couple of things today. We celebrated Bob and Pat Ostenbach. Oh, good, Jan, I'm glad you have sound. Hopefully Bonnie will be able to figure out what's going on with her computer or phone. You know, this technology is constantly switching up on us, isn't it? Anyway, Pat and Bob Ostenbach celebrated 60 years of marriage this past Thursday, I think they said. So I'm really, really happy to see them in worship today. I want to ask you to keep praying for Bob. You know, he said he broke his back twice when he was younger, and now he's suffering all that pain in sciatica and down his leg. So we're asking God to take good care of Bob. Anyway, and then we also celebrated Karen's 20 years of ministry in our congregation as our musician. And there was a collection secretly taken and a deal made with her family to show up and some cake and flowers for her. Actually, if you still want to give offerings to her, you're welcome to do so. I'm sure that the church will continue to collect for her if you happen to miss that, because I wasn't allowed to really share that publicly when she was in the room. But so far, she received a check for $1,300 from this congregation. And our president, Doug, shared how many miles she must have driven in her car over those 20 years, and of course, how many hours. And he testified to her presence in this space and gratitude to her family for her energy and time shared with us in this place, not just as a musician on the organist, but also as a friend in quilting and a Christian sister in Christ here. So she's been a blessing. She's a very shy person when it comes to all that praise, but you can imagine how much gratitude. There was even a standing ovation in the building shared with Karen, and I know that you have greetings of praise and gratitude for her too. So if you'd like to drop her a note, I'm sure she'll take letters in the mail. We all like that snail mail these days. Thank you, Karen. Yesterday was the New Cumberland Apple Festival, and a large group of our contingent here, as we call it in Staten Island, the usual suspects, we're starting to choose that name here. So it's the same crew of people that often show up to do a lot of that work. They started on Friday night schlepping out tables and chairs and hot dogs and all the goodies that we would need Saturday. And we served up hot dogs for $1. And I think we were the cheapest lunch on the row. But it was really helpful, I think, also for families, especially if you got a large crew. To get a hot dog for $1 can make a big difference for somebody's pocketbook if they want to do some spending on Apple supplies and things like that rather than just buying lunch. Even so, at that price, the congregation was able to make over $900 selling hot dogs and sausage and drinks. So I'm very grateful to this community, because you're going to hear in my sermon that there was more going on than just serving hot dogs to a community in need. And I'll share that more with you later. Some other things that are coming up in our community. Next Sunday, we will be having our pet blessing. At 10:30, it's gonna be a different view in here because you're not gonna be in here. We're gonna be using my cell phone to record a pet blessing outside in the, we have a grassy area with fencing, and I'm encouraging folks to show up who are local to bring their pets for a little blessing. And if you can't physically be here, or even if you can be, but you can't bring your pet, and you wanna just bring a picture, maybe on your cell phone or print it out, you can share that with us as well, and we'll do a pet blessing that way. And we're also going to do a time of remembrance of those pets that have died that we really miss. Some of us grieve really hard, like as if this was our own personal child. And for many of us, when I was younger, my parents would call my dogs their grand dogs because I didn't have any children yet in my life. So, you know, it gets to be like family, these guys. But if you've got that, prepare to be ready with us. And then what we'll do is after the pet blessing, we'll shut down the online and then come back in the building for the rest of the worship and we'll restart. So there'll be kind of like a little break between, and I'll announce it next Sunday so you don't get lost. You'll find us again. The week after that is an event in our town also known as Vicky's Angel Walk. This congregation opens up our building for those who are walking to support. I think it's cancer, is that right? It's a cancer walk. And this is an agency right here in town, Vicky's Angel Walk. And they will be walking on a Saturday. And what we'll do is we'll open up our church building so the walkers can use the restroom. We'll distribute water to them and encourage them on their walk to keep going. If you're in the vicinity and you'd like to be helpful, we could use some more help on that Saturday. Just contact Doug or me here and we'll help you get connected. Those are the announcements that I have, other than if you've got some prayer requests, please do share those here in the comments. And I'm gonna ask Jim to collect those up and share them with me on my cell phone, because they have changed up Facebook once again. The settings on my computer means that I cannot see all of your messages to me and do the other part of my work on here. So he's gonna have to send me messages that you're here and that you have prayers. Please do that throughout. Even if you are not watching us live, you can send a message to us and we'll include prayers. Now I've got a few that I wanna share with you quickly before we get into our worship. This past week, we had I had the service for Dennis Boyer and his family, and we're going to ask you to keep the Boyer family in your prayers upon his death. Sue Smith her mom has just, Eleanor Muller has entered into hospice, and you know, hospice is a really wonderful space for us to keep us comfortable, but it's been hard on the family. So I'm going to ask you to pray for Eleanor Muller's family, and especially for Sue, an active member of our community here at St. Paul's. Art Hall is in his 90s and he's in the rehab following a stroke. Ed Ulsh is a member of the Church of God here in New Cumberland, and he's home after hospitalization with COVID. Jean Ruth had a mastectomy, so we're going to pray for her and, of course, all who are dealing with cancer these days. And then I was asked to remember Josie, a dog who died, and you see what I mean, how close it is to the heart. Glenn Simmons and Joe Holden's family, and J.B. Bowman. And then we had a prayer for Pat Buell, because her husband Ted died on Thursday, so we're going to pray for Pat as she grieves over the loss of Ted. Those are the prayer requests that I have thus far. As we get further along and you share yours with us and then Jim passes them along to me, I'll share them. Now we're gonna be hearing all of the readings today, but my sermon will be focused on the reading from James. So when we get to that part, listen close, because that's the stuff of which I'm gonna be drawing upon for our time of preaching. I just realized that I didn't even tell you who I was, so if you're just checking in with us for the first time, I'm Reverend Jennifer Richards, otherwise known as Pastor Jenny. My colleague here is Karen, and she's on the piano and organ and whatever else we get her to share with us, so we thank her for being here too. From Donna Rittler, we're going to pray for Ed Ulsh. I've got him in there. Did I not have Ed? Yes. We do have him in there. Thank you, Donna. And good morning. And I see Holly Kutz. That must be that she and Dave are back from Hawaii. God love you. I wish I could go with you to Hawaii. They're in Savannah right now. So God bless you. Glad you're here. All right. Let us take a moment to breathe and call upon the name of the Lord as we make the sign of the cross over ourselves. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless. Amen. Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter, like lost sheep, we've gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed. Free us from our sins. Gracious God, listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. We're going to sing a song called, Oh, Sing to the Lord. Looks like we have five verses. Should we do a couple of them? One, two, and five sounds good to me. Out there dancing. That's a great one. Last week when we were at the picnic and Karen was playing and we were singing, kids were walking past and dancing. I don't know, did you notice? You were busy playing. But it was great. Let us pray the prayer of the day. Generous God, your Son gave his life that we might come to peace with you. Give us a share of your Spirit. And in all we do, empower us to bear the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading comes from that book called Numbers. It's the 11th chapter. All right, we're going to hear from Numbers. The rabble among them had a strong craving. And the Israelites also wept again. And said, if only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we used to eat in Egypt for nothing. The cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up and there's nothing at all but this manna to look at. Moses heard the people weeping throughout their families, all at the entrances of their tents. Then the Lord became very angry, and Moses was displeased. So Moses said to the Lord, why have you treated your servant so badly? Why have I not found favor in your sight, that you lay the burden of all your people on me? Did I conceive all these people? Did I give birth to them that you should say to me, carry them in your bosom and nurse as and a nurse carries a suckling child to the land that you promised on oath to their ancestors? Where am I to get meat to give all to all these people? For they come weeping to me and say, give us meat to eat. I am not able to carry all this people alone, for they are too heavy for me. If this is the way you're going to treat me, put me to death at once. If I have found favor in your sight, and do not let me see my misery. So the Lord said to Moses, gather for me 70 of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people, and officers over them. Bring them to the tent of meeting, and have them take their place there with you. So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord. And he gathered 70 elders of the people and placed them all around the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied, but they did not do so again. Two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad, and the Spirit rested on them. They were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent, and so they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, son of Nun, the assistant of Moses, one of his chosen men, said, "My lord Moses, stop them." But Moses said to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit on them." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. What a great passage. Doesn't it sound like us? Just put me to death already, God. All right, well, we're moving now into our psalm. This is Psalm 19, and the very final verse, 14, is one I bet you know by heart. So if you're joining me and you don't have a Bible in front of you, you can listen, but if you've got one, you can follow along. The teaching of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the simple. The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold. Sweeter far than honey in the comb. By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can detect one's own offenses? Cleanse me from my secret faults. Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense. Here comes verse 14, if you know it, say it with me. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And here's the text from James, the fifth chapter. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick. And the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Listen to the word that God has spoken. Listen to the one who is close at hand. Listen to the voice that began creation. passion. Listen even if you don't understand. The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 9th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able to soon afterwards speak evil of me. Whoever's not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good. But if salt loses its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. That's a tough text, but I'd be happy to talk to anybody who wants to talk about that message from Jesus. Complicated, but it's good stuff. And in fact, Jim wrote a really lovely article in our Wednesday newsletter, so you can find some good stuff in there from him. And thanks, Jim, for that. All right. What I want to tell you is that I'm focusing on James. Because if you look at the book chronologically in the Bible, the books of the Bible, this letter from James is probably, it was definitely written before the Gospels were. So this is really early in the community of the faithful in their writings. So let me tell you a little bit about this letter before we jump right into what I wanted to tell you. James, these are the last seven verses from his letter that we had today in our reading. And he's writing to people in the diaspora. That would be the Jewish Christians that were not living in Jerusalem, where he's from. And believe it or not, James is believed to have been the younger brother of Jesus. So probably the next son born to Mary. This guy, more than likely, according to historians of the Christian tradition, did not follow Jesus initially, but by the time we get this letter written, which is somewhere in the 50s or 60s, not 1950s and 60s, but the originals, after Christ was born, being the brother of Jesus, that this material from James, by this time James is a leader of the council in Jerusalem, so the earliest council of the church. James was visited by the very well-known Apostle Paul at least twice. Paul tells us that he's visited James. So the only other book that might have been written before James's letter to the community would be Galatians. But otherwise, this is a letter written for practical living. Many of you have heard that Martin Luther really wasn't a big fan of this letter from James, but that was because Dr. Martin was trying to kind of change the emphasis from our good works to the mercy of Jesus. He wrestled with that as a religious leader. But he did ultimately say that this is a good book to lean into. And James is trying to teach us what it means to be a Christian, not just to have faith in Christ, but that faith needs to be lived out. And this brings me to my material for you today. What I find interesting is how he chooses to end his letter with a reminder of the power of prayer. Relationships around prayer. Because prayer is actually another way of saying relationship. Prayer is really communication. It's talking. And James tells us that there's power in that communication, in that talking. Many of us choose to kind of sit with that secret stuff inside of us, sometimes from shame, sometimes because we're just plain stubborn, sometimes because we don't even know what to name it, but we sit with a lot of garbage inside of us, unwilling or unable to let out the pain and the sorrow. But the call of James here in this letter is to let it out, or to confess. That's another way of saying it. To tell someone, especially God, or a fellow Christian, a sister or brother in Christ. This act of reflection and confession that we do is part of our worship, and you get to do this before we even begin our liturgy. That's what we do. We stop for a moment of quiet to reflect before God. And sometimes in that sharing of the burdens with God, we let it go. It just is lifted up and the Holy Spirit takes it from us. Sometimes it's so overwhelming we cannot even speak words, and that's when the Bible tells us that the Spirit groans on our behalf. That the Lord knows what's going on deep inside of us and wants to be in relationship with that place of us to heal us. And what we cannot handle, God can. So we can take God and take it to God and say, what I cannot live with, Lord, help me live with the consequences of whatever it is. If I cannot physically change it, let's say it's a physical problem or an emotional problem or a systemic problem that's way bigger than us, and we can't fix the problem, we can turn to God and say, help me live through the consequences and be strong enough and bear up beneath all of the weight of these things. The other gift that's given to the church in addition to that confessional space part of the worship is community. According to James, that we have one another to confess to, so we can, in our times together, talk with one another and share with each other. And then there are people in the community, and Dee actually showed up after church to remind me that before COVID, we would do this. It's called anointing, right? So we would have communion, folks would come up, before we had to do communion in our pews with our little cups, we would come up as a community and commune together. And folks would then go off to people who would pray. And we had a member, we have a member who would have some holy oil, and she would say, what would you like me to pray for today? The person would confess, right? Let go of what it is that they needed to have prayer over, whether it's their own self or someone else in their life or a body part that's needing healing. And she would make the sign of the cross in oil on their forehead or on their hand, wherever they're most comfortable, and just say a brief prayer. And we would just keep that moving through during the communion time. And it's possible also to have done in private conversation if it's not, there's not enough time to communicate that in a very short time on a communion Sunday. So I'm looking forward to, we all are looking forward to that day when COVID is no longer keeping us from hugging one another, from putting oil on the head of a confessor, and being able to sing again. We all long for those days. But until then, you can still have folks praying for each other, which is why you offer these prayers throughout the service, and I'm grateful. So yesterday, I think I told you we had the New Cumberland Apple Festival, and it may have looked like just a bunch of us standing out there cooking and collecting money and talking to people about our hot dogs and sausages, but what was really going on was something much, much deeper. And I think it was probably the first time in my recollection that we've had a chance to do this with one another on a large scale like this. As we gathered, we chatted with one another and even confessed a little bit to each other that life is pretty heavy from time to time. Some of us are feeling too old or alone. Some of us are sick or newly diagnosed with a disease. Some of us are living in pain and worry about others in our families. And boy, that was just my confession. I'm kidding. No, seriously, this was going on in our midst with one another. We were confessing to each other these very things about our lives. Even those who were not recognizing it as confession were in fact telling one another what, you know, just how are things going? And then that conversation would take place. Ultimately, God was part of that conversation too. Where two or three are gathered, right? There is God in our midst, listening. Life comes at us and we feel really overwhelmed. We worry about ourselves and the people that we care about, but God does not leave us in that place. Just like in that Apple Festival, I think being there and listening to one another made a huge difference for some of us, just to know that others were there and care about us. According to James, God gives us the power to do something about that confession. James 5:16 says, "Therefore confess your sins to one another and pray for each other so that you may be healed." The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Now you may question, well, where am I going to find me a righteous person? And I'm certainly not the righteous one to be listening, right? I don't have everything right in my life. Well, we Christians understand that righteousness doesn't come from us. It comes from God to us. So it's God that makes our hearts right and turns us in the right way. So in that conversation, the righteous person, that would be us by God's presence in our midst, is providing that healing, and it is powerful and effective, according to James. God's the one who brings righteousness into the relationship. For all of us sin and fall short of the glory of God, so we need God to be part of that conversation. That's why when we speak to one another, that is when we confess or tell someone what's happening inside of our lives, God is present in that conversation and provides the healing to us. Sometimes it's just getting it out there, the power that comes from speaking it. And sometimes it actually does heal us. The person next to us who's listening says, "You're not alone. And you're not going to have to deal with this alone. I'll walk with you through all of it, no matter what's coming your way. I'm here." And that can be so powerful and relieve us from a lot of the strain of carrying things alone. And sometimes when someone says, "I forgive you, it's really okay," then we can also forgive ourselves for what happened. James 5:15 says that the Lord will raise you up, and if you've sinned, you will be forgiven. That feels good, doesn't it? But suffering isn't the only part of this conversation, is it? Verse 13 also includes, "Is anyone happy?" I asked Pat and Bob, "Are you happy for your anniversary?" And they both said yes, but they were joking around earlier, right? You know, if you are happy, it says, then sing songs of praise. And this, too, is the gift that we find in our community. We sing. We join together in worship of God. Many of us, even in our suffering times, have songs of praise that fill us with joy and hope and expectation of God's presence among us. So we can turn on the radio or turn on, recordings of music that fill us with hope. Sometimes there's even power in the midst of struggle to sing against that pain. The words that I'm reminded of are from Martin Luther, where he said, when you sing, you're praying twice. How about it? So if you're out there humming along or singing in the car or in the shower or whatever, just know that you're also praying twice. These short 7 verses from James are packed with power and hope. James even includes an ancient allusion to the prayer, that powerful prayer of Elijah to stop the rain and restart the rain. But I think for me, the more powerful image of prayer comes from Jesus himself. He was all about prayer. In fact, his main thing was to tell us that we have a Father in heaven, that we can call someone as close as like Daddy, someone that we can rely on and be sure he's got our back. In fact, every time you look at Jesus in the Bible, you're going to find him trying to get away from the crowds to pray. Or even like in the Garden of Gethsemane, he was praying. And you think about him on the cross. He even prayed from the cross to the Father. But he also taught his disciples how to pray. And you know what it's called, right? The Our Father or the Lord's Prayer. And then, of course, for me, one of the most poignant moments of prayer was when he was in front of the tomb of Lazarus. And he says to the Father, he's like, I'm talking to you out loud, Lord, to Father, not for my sake, because I know you always hear me, but for their sake, so that they can see that we have this conversation and that you always listen to us, that you listen and that you care. So I think that's really powerful stuff that Jesus was trying to teach all of us, just like James is his brother trying to teach us, that God is near us and always listening, even when we feel that we are alone. We can turn to God. Jesus opens this relationship up for us in the scriptures and teaching us that life is an ongoing conversation. We teach our children, right, to pray before we eat, to pray before we go to bed, to pray when we wake up in the morning, so we can pray ceaselessly, that our lives are always surrounded by the one who loves us. Jesus came just to teach us that, I think, especially in person, what love looks like, in dying and rising and healing and feeding, and ultimately promising never to leave us. So God came down to say, look, this relationship is important. And Jesus promises at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, surely I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. So there is no letting go of us. God wants to hold on to us always. My friends, do not despair. God is with you today. When you need reassurance of that, simply speak your joys and your sorrows to the great I am. And you can be certain that God does hear you and love you. And when you need to hear those words spoken aloud, find a friend, a fellow Christian. Ask for anointing oil. Or go to the Apple Festival if you can. Whatever it takes, find a space where you can confess or share what's going on. Really, you can also be that listening ear for your fellow, for your Christian friends and your non-Christian friends. Someone who needs to have someone listen. It's powerful. As James, our brother in Christ, ends his letter, the earliest Christians tells us that it has the power to heal and the power to forgive. That's mighty powerful stuff. Well, why don't we end this time with a little bit of prayer as I take a look at what requests you put in there, but I'm going to end my sermon here with a prayer. The Lord be with you and also with you. God of hope and light and joy and freedom and despair and sorrow, we thank you in all the good times and the bad and the hard times, and when things come across our life that we don't feel we can handle, we thank you that you've sent Jesus to show us. And then you taught his younger brother, James, to tell the church, listen up, listen to my brother. He'll tell you what it means to love. We thank you for coming in person, Jesus, and for showing us what love is, laying down your life for us, You love us so much that you would even raise not just yourself, but all of us to new life in you. We thank you for that new life. We thank you for your strength in the midst of our sorrows and struggles. And those places, Lord, that we cannot handle, we turn over to you right now. We ask that you handle those things in our lives. Give us the courage to face the days ahead. We thank you for this time together with Christians here around this computer screen or phone or whatever we're using to hear your good news. Bless us now as we enter into this time of prayer with one another. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Our hymn of the day is Christ Be Our Light, 715 in the ELW. There's five verses of this. Have you thought how many we might do? 1, 2, 5 again. I like that. That's easy.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people. Light for the world to see. Christ be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ be our light. Shine in our church. Gathered today. Longing for peace. Our world is troubled. Longing for hope. Many despair. Your word alone has power to save us. Make us your living voice. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light. Shine in your church. Gathered today. Many the gifts, many the people, many the hearts that yearn to belong. Let us be saints to one another, signs of your kingdom come. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine. Christ be our light, shine in your church, gathered today.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So I do see from Jim that there are some more prayer requests in here. I'm going to try to write them in my book so I don't forget them during the week. If you've got more, you're welcome to join us in adding them in as well. From Bonnie Urban, we're going to pray for Trudy Urban. Sunny's mother, who's celebrating 90 years. I guess that's her birthday? Yes, 90th birthday. Oh, that's wonderful. And we sure hope that Sunny's doing better after all that hospital stuff, Bonnie. Please do keep us up to speed on how Sonny's been doing, and you too. And then from Donna, we're going to pray also for Bob and Maggie Fogelman. Who else shall we pray for? You've got people that you want us to pray for? And from Donna, we got yours earlier about Ed Ulsh. Are there other prayers that you want us to pray for? Please do send us a message and we'll include them in our prayer time. All right, we're going to continue now with our prayers. Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. We pray for the church and its ministry. Bless the newly baptized and encourage them in their journey of faith. Sustain all members of the body of Christ in lives of prayer, service, and worship. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for natural wonders of your creation, and I'm thinking of new babies that are born, right? Oh, thank you, God, for those beautiful blessings. But we're also praying for waterways and forests and natural areas around where we live. So why don't you lift up some of the names of those places that you're praying for? In our backyard, we have Fishing Creek. And yesterday at the park, we were next to the Yellow Breeches. What are you praying for in the world today? Restore damaged forests, God, waterways, and natural habitats, and lead us to be good stewards of what you have provided. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hey, Mary Shue, I'm thinking of you down by the Gulf waters. How beautiful it must be there for you these days. I pray for that place where I used to sit and enjoy praying and talking and confessing my life with my friends there. We thank you, God, for all those places where we confess. We pray for those who are in authority, Lord. Give them wise minds and compassionate hearts. Strengthen in them a desire to protect the vulnerable and care for those underserved. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are struggling, Lord, today, especially with cancer or mental illnesses or dementia or other diseases. Provide them with peace and resilience, Lord, for the days ahead. Sustain caregivers with energy and patience. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the worship leaders in this community of faith here. I want to say thank you, God, for Jim, who is always here helping us. We thank you for Dave, who continues to work with our computer stuff. We thank you for the gift of the musician of 20 years in this community of faith, our friend Karen. We pray for who is reading and for acolytes and who's ushering in our midst. What other roles should we include? How about those prayer warriors in our midst? We thank you, God, for those folks. Bless us through their ministry and grant them the passion to continue in their service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now we enter into those who we are praying for by name. We pray for the sick, especially these folks, Lord. Peggy Warmcastle, Ken Dapp, Heather Yoder, Anita Painter, Bailey and Carter, Tyler and Trevor, Kristen Klingeman and Kristen's cousin, Rick. We pray for Pat Hefner, Donald Dravick, Jan Barrick, Hannah, Greg Mitchell, Sue Lohman, Antonelli and Nestor, Andy Barrier, Jay Swope, Bob Hall, Karen Kaler, Julie Snyder, Woody Isher, Skip Krepich, Sean, Joan Folkrode. We're praying also for Sue Smith's mother, Eleanor Muller. We pray for Art Hall following his stroke, and Ed Ulsh, who's recovering from COVID. We pray for Jean Ruth following her mastectomy. We pray for Glenn Simmons, Joe Holden's family, for J.B. Bowman, For Trudy Urban, for Bob and Maggie Fogelman, who else shall we name before you, Lord? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for all your saints, those we have loved and known, and those from every time and place. Today we remember the family of Dennis L. Boyer as we lay his body to rest this coming week. We pray for Ted Buell and his wife, Pat, who is grieving his loss, and all of his friends. We pray for Ted as he is laid to rest this coming week as well. We also lift before you, Lord, those whom we miss. We pray especially for families who have lost their pets, like Josie. Continue to guide us by their example and reassure us of your promised salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those celebrating anniversaries and birthdays, especially the Osenbachs on their 60th wedding anniversary, we thank you, God, for those gifts of relationship. We pray that you would bless the years to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts that are known only to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always, and also with you. Hug on yourself if you're by yourself, or pass the peace with a friend. Peace be with you. It's so good to be in your midst today. I sure hope that life is going well. I haven't been able to see. If you've got a minute and you want to send the passing of the peace to others here in our midst, you can do that. You can write a peace be with you. Look at that. I see a few of you are sending those. Wonderful. How about Trudy Urban, who's celebrating her 90th birthday today? We thank you, God, for that. What a gift to be 90, huh? You know, Gene told me he's 89, so next year we're going to have a big celebration for him. And I forget who told me there. I think it might be the Melnicheks are on a 9, and next year I think it might be 40 years of marriage or something like that. I said, oh, it's time to celebrate big on those big decade years. And Tom and I are going to be 10 years next year, and our daughter-in-law and our son. Any of you also getting ready for a big celebration? It's so good to see you in worship today. I'm so glad you're here. All right, we've passed the peace. It is now time to kind of wind up our worship together. If you want to continue to share that peace with one another, go ahead as we close our worship with the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. People of God, you are Christ's body, bringing new life to a suffering world. The Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Amen. Love, divine, all loves excelling. It's only 4 verses. I say we do them all. What do you say, Karen? Can we do all 4? Did you already pick out ones you wanted to do? No? Okay. Let's do all 4. We'll enjoy singing together. Fix in us thy heart. Peace, brothers and sisters. The living word dwells in you. Thanks be to God, we will. Oh, she's making her way over to the organ. Before I let you go, I'm going to ask Karen to come down here and join me just for a second so you can see her. And I wanted to say good morning to a few of you while she's on her way down. I saw that Barb Love is here and Donna Rittler and Bonnie and Sonny. And I believe also, who else is here that I haven't said hello and good morning to? Did I say Holly and Dave Kutz, good morning to you? Is it Eileen Murphy's here too? Jan, your sister joined us. That's great. Who else? Oh, is Sandra and Gil, are they here this morning? I want to just say thank you. Oh, and there's Mandy Jones. Good morning, Mandy. I'm so glad you could be with us in church too this morning. Oh, there's Karen. Just popped the camera up so we could see. Karen, this is the musician I've been pointing to, but she's been kind of hiding over there. I didn't turn the camera to her. So I just wanted to give you a chance to see Karen and offer her your greetings, to say good morning and thank you to her for all the gifts that she shares with us. I'm sure there's lots of you that have already sent greetings in. 20 years. Look, there's Anita Painter. She wrote, congrats on 20 years, Karen. Oh, and Mary, she wrote, thank you. Yes, see, there are folks here that are, and Jan Rutman, my other sister Karen joined us too. Oh, that's great news, Jan. That's wonderful. So thank you for your gifts to us. And we pray for another 20 years, don't we? I don't know if she wants to give us 20 more, but...
She said, you won't be here when I'm 94.
94, is that right? Oh, you just gave us your age. You might be. It could very well be. I'm so glad that you guys could be here for worship. Yeah, Bill Fuhrer. Yeah. Yay, Karen. All right, folks, so we're going to sign off now and say we'll see you next week. Just remember, when you see us, it's going to be kind of hectic because it's going to be with all the pets. We're going to start outside, so be ready for a little bit of a jumpy kind of start to our worship. And if you're a few minutes late, don't worry. We'll be right back on again in this space next Sunday after that pet blessing at 10:30. Peace be with you. Love you. Take care.